But just two things. Caste has been pushed onto the table of the EU Parliament. So, the powers that be in this country are more than happy to devote time, energy and resources to make sure the European Parliament is discussing alleged disputes which occur within our communities without evidence, whilst being in a European Union of 27 nations who do not even acknowledge the oldest living religious tradition on the planet. Who's discriminating? Right? One case is too much, remember? But 27 countries saying you guys don't even have any official status as a religion. That's okay, that's not discrimination. I would suggest, and I'll speak really slowly for the camera so that we can share this with the Indian government and other parliamentary officers, that at this moment in time, when the whole world wants to do business with India, whether it's European countries, as we saw at the Diwali in Parliament, whether it's, yes, a European country that we're in at this moment in time, and we'll hopefully stay in a European country, although the EU is separate, we have this particular issue and an opportunity. We should be saying to them, if you want to do business with the grassroots Hindu, the grassroots Sikh, the grassroots community in our country, at least do us the courtesy of recognising that we are not the infidel, heathen, pagan, unwashed natives which your religious institutions have been telling you about. We want our people in Britain, we want the British people, we want the Indian people, we want the European people to have mutual respect, and they can do trade. But if they're not even willing to acknowledge our religious traditions, why on earth should we engage in business with people who are so discriminatory and so prejudiced? It's a very, very real and valid question. Lakshmiji, thank you so much for all the efforts that you're putting into the European effort. Everyone who is speaking today, please also bear in mind, they're all volunteers. And more often than not, the institutions that we're butting up against, they have full-time paid employees. So the seva that's being done by the volunteers is even harder and even more worthy of respect. Turning to our next speaker, who is our keynote speaker. He has been doing this seva for 40 years, I think 40 plus years now. And he's devoted his life to the protection of the vulnerable in our religious tradition in India. We are at the beginning of a process. Mohanji has very clearly identified that in times gone past, the Indian experience of Islamic extremists, he has highlighted, and this is recorded in our Shastra. In the UK and in Europe, we're now beginning to see the first signs of it. Western Bengal is actually much further along in this process. Mm-hmm. And there have been battles for the last 40, 50 years plus. And so it would be wonderful for us to have an opportunity to perhaps look further down the line and see what happens when the intolerant are tolerated without scrutiny, without judgment being applied. So I would welcome Tapan Ghosh to join us, and he has come all the way from his duties and his challenges in India to be with us, to celebrate Diwali, and also to cast light on this most dark of subjects. So, Tapan Ghosh.
Respectable guests and the respectable audience. I am not comfortable and easy with English and also with this dress. Excuse me. You please try to understand what I am trying to tell. Today's subject is tolerate the intolerance. But the next question comes, how long, how much and to what extent? To the extent like our Gandhar. The Gandhar was once a very highly progressed civilization, of which once a very small example was there, the Bamiyan Buddha temple, Buddha statue, which has been destroyed. And not only that Bamiyan Buddha statue, there from came our Gandhari. You know the mother of Duryodhan and the high character she possessed. So where that character was built? Not after her marriage, but before her marriage. That means in Gandhar. And what the situation of Gandhar today? It is now Kandahar, where our IC-814 plane was hijacked and landed, and we were compelled to release the very khunkhar terrorist from our Indian jail. And just 2-3 years back, that Afghanistan was considered as the highest danger zone in the world. So today's Taliban's land, today's the danger zone, that was our land, and the great civilization was there. But that is changed. Not only Gandhar, you see Punjab, you see Sindh, you see East Bengal. In all these areas, I see here that you are very much worried about the issue of grooming. That is, your girls, your daughters are threatened. But in our country, our land is threatened. Our very existence is threatened. And when in 1947, our country, our motherland, which we consider as a living being, that was partitioned, that was divided, the logic was given that we had so long quarrel and dispute, and once for all this dispute will be solved, please accept this partition, etc. All these logics were put up. But what we saw? With the bloodshed, with the massacre of 1946-47, we accepted partition, we gave up our land, we became refugees in tens of millions. But after just 43 years of that partition in 1990, our again Hindus have to be were expelled from Kashmir Valley. That means in 1947 that problem was not solved, and therefore our Deegan leaders, either they misguided us or they were ignorant. They could not see what is the root cause of the threat. And therefore, after Pakistan, after partition, then Kashmir. And is that trend, that direction is stopped or reversed? But we see that is not stopped. Again, more land may be Hindu-less. Therefore, since we Bengal, West Bengal, we are in the border, and we are one time victim of this partition, and after partition, we took West Bengal, at least 2 crores of Hindu refugees from East Pakistan. Therefore, Hindus' percentage should have gone up there. But instead, in 1947, when in our part of Bengal, that is West Bengal, there was 19% Muslim and 81% Hindu, and today there is 30% Muslim and 70% Hindu. How it happened? We took so many Hindu refugees, therefore, in spite of that, their number is going up and up, and all these are being tolerated for political correctness, for the peculiar conception of secularism, of tolerance, etc. And too big to be tolerant, we will lose our land, we will again become refugees. Your Western world is much worried about Islamic terrorism. But in India, we are not worried about the Lashkar-e-Toyba or Al-Qaeda, etc. Because in the remote rural areas, there these terrorist organizations, they don't strike. But there, our common people, very innocent rural people in the remote areas, they are bullied, They are threatened, they are scared, and their daughters, their sisters are snatched away. What is called love jihad? I call it fraud jihad, by deceit jihad. Our daughters and girls are being snatched away. And all these, this voting democracy, electoral democracy, it made the situation more dangerous for our Hindus. Therefore, here whenever I come to, three times I visited US and first time in UK, I always hear from you about the human rights violation. But I am a little confused that our existence is threatened. Then the human rights violation, since the real thing is that you are actually secure, we are not secure. And this, I am coming to the point, terrorism. Where the suicide bombers are built, where these human fodders are created, in the madrasas. It is as simple. If you pick up a child at the age of 5 or 6 or 4 and you start to indoctrinate him or her, then what will be the result? And the entire world, entire human civilization will not see the threat in this madrasa education. Can we expect that 4 year, 5 year, 6 year child, he is going to madrasa and he is taught this, that, etc. Mumin, kafir, jihad, jannat, all these things. And its consequence we have to face. Therefore, my appeal to the entire humanity, my appeal to the Western people, that please put on your government, put on your institutions to put pressure on these Middle East countries who always send money to proliferation of madrasas. It is dangerous for our humanity. Therefore, we are now, the thing is human rights violation. So we have to protect our land. And when we in India we say that Hindus are being victim of this communal or sectarian aggression, atrocities, etc. Sometimes the world cannot believe it, because you are there still 80%. So majority they torture upon the minority, and you are 80%. You say that you are being tortured. How it can happen? But this is happening. Therefore, my humble submission that this human rights violation, yes, you do it here, but we have to protect our land, we have to protect our civilization, we have to protect our culture, we have to protect our religion. Therefore, we must build our defense force. And that is our duty, that is my duty. And I am not very much eager to expand my work all over India. I want to create a role model in my state, West Bengal, which was once victim of partition, that no more, and we will not allow to make our West Bengal like Kashmir like situation. Therefore, it is our duty to protect our land, our culture, our religion, and I am building that force. And another notion is that Hindus are not that much courageous, etc., etc. I do not accept at all this thing. Hindus never lose any battle. Hindus lose battle either before fighting it or after in the table. However, there are courageous Hindus, particularly from the economically and educationally backward communities, and they are the most sufferer of these atrocities, of these religious atrocities. Therefore, it is our duty to, today you know very well that that caste or varna in practice is, does not depend upon the birth. Therefore, today, the protector of the society, which we call Kshatriya, these Kshatriyas will come out and coming out from the backward section of the our society, and we have to give them honor, we have to give them respect that you are our protector, you are Kshatriya, and we must stand by them in their self-resistance and to protect the our country, our province, our land, our religion, our culture, our civilization. That work we are doing and we are getting success thanks to the more and more Islamic fundamentalism, radicalism and terrorism perhaps, and also thanks to the appeasement for vote, getting more vote, more block vote. We are doing this work totally non-politically. My organization's name is Hindu Samhati, that means Hindu Solidarity. And perhaps understand that in a democracy, in electoral democracy, the people will be divided among the political parties. No? 100% people cannot come to one single party. Now, if we want to make solidarity among the Hindus, therefore I must not follow a particular political party. Because in politics, in power politics, there are many issues. A simple example you take in our India, reservation policy. Either if you take reservation policy, some people will be disappointed, they will be angry. If you scrap reservation, some people will be disappointed and angry. But if you want to bring all Hindus at the same platform, then you must not be attached with a single political party. That is the basic condition, I think, of any community solidarity. And therefore, I am trying to do this, build up this Hindu Defense Force, non-politically, that means non-partisan way. I must have some political opinion, but if I have to give opinion on reservation, on this, on economic policy, on GST, etc., then naturally many people may not agree with me. Therefore, this work, this protecting our land and culture and our religion and honor of our women and the honor of our temples, our deities, which are regularly attacked. There are so many riots in Bengal. Just last July, there was big riot. And that is a long list I don't want to put here. To resist all this, to protect ourselves, whatever I am trying to do, that is build up the Hindu Defense Force, particularly from the backward communities and non-partisan, non-political way. And I need blessings of all of you. Thank you.